Today is taken from Francis Dugan. A difference of opinions. A difference of opinions just means you and I, on different subjects, do not see eye to eye. And who is wrong or right is not for me to say, since we all look at life in a different way. On any one subject, all will not agree. That's what right to you may not be right to me. If we all thought the same, how boring we would be, though to said what we dislike in others, in ourselves, we do see. 'Tis our individuality from others that places us apart. But what does matter most is you be kind of heart, and you do not find joy in another's downfall, and you embrace the truth in a fair go for all. We are all individuals for want of a better name, and even those with similar views do not exactly the same. Despite a common ancestry and similar DNA, we look at life in a different way. Of similar things many of us may dream, but we are quite different, or so it does seem. Though we can be judged by the company we keep, the karma we sow is the karma we reap.
Mick Bray and Posy Robertson, and Mick's bio says he is a farmer. He is a graduate of the University of Illinois Agriculture Science, a graduate of the U.S. Air Force Fighter Pilot School, one-time president of the Verdon School Board, and current vice president of his household. He's proud to appear here with U.S. Army big rig driver Vi Lanham and Cessna pilot Posy Robertson. And he wants to remind you that our dear departed friend Wes Diker once called him his nemesis, but he hopes Wes was kidding. And Posy was born Roseanne Overacre, but now is mostly known as Posy Robertson. She is a Springfield native and graduated from Springfield High School in 1948, graduated from Northwestern University with a BSBA in 52, and Northern University Evening Division MBA in 1960, one of only two women in the MBA class. What did I say?
Northern.
Okay, Northwestern, one of only two women in the MBA class. She's had a career in corporate America in human resources and labor relations. She's currently a community volunteer. Over the past year, she's worked with the American Red Cross, taught first aid and water safety, disaster relief locally and for national events. She volunteers also at the Dana Thomas House as an interpreter and at various special events, and at the Lincoln Presidential Library Oral History Project.
My family was strongly Republican. My dad's father, that'd be my grandfather, said, "If the Republicans nominate the devil, vote for him." No kidding. However, having transferred my beliefs to UU, such a vote would be impossible, or at minimum would have to refer to the devil as him or her. My parents instilled in me the importance of personal responsibility, a strong key to my beliefs. They presented Mother Nature to me in person in countless ways, and her, or his, web became a true love. I'm just an ordinary person, not a college professor, no PhD, no great successes to claim, but I have had a very long time to find out for myself why I am a Republican. Though after learning there's no hell, I voted on occasion for a Democrat who was the best candidate. I did. My friend Mick will present a more academic view of famous thinkers. Originally, I planned to offer a list of all the really important things that Republicans want for themselves and for their families. I was going to start with satisfying Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And from there on, my good friend Frank, the distinguished UIS professor, Frank Kopecky, provided an excellent additional list quite well 2 weeks ago. Thank you, Frank. Save me time. Believe it or not, I believe that most Republicans agree with most of the outcomes you listed. Good schools so individuals can be personally responsible, equality of opportunity and of justice in an open society, society and safety and peace, good medical care, a good life for all, etc., etc. You tied using these power, using our powers to help and not to hinder, to heal and not to harm, and to respect the inherent worth and dignity of others. I lost many nights' sleep after agreeing to do to address you today. The problem was to pack, you should see the pile of clippings I have, to pack so much into so little time. Since it's impossible, please let me tackle just a couple of issues, and I will welcome further dialogue elsewhere on other subjects. The Democrat worldview holds that big government, government which centralizes power, government which consolidates responsibility and authority, decisions and actions at the top of a hierarchy, is the best universal solution to reach all the outcomes we all want. On the other hand, Democrats deplore bigness in the private sector with a long record of passing laws and regulations to limit size. Democrats don't like the bigness of monopolies, except for the federal government, of course, but don't much like competition either. They probably don't watch the Olympics. Republicans believe competition and free markets challenge companies to excel, thereby keeping costs and prices low and encouraging the development of new and better products or services and expanding job opportunities. Republicans believe in individual personal responsibility for outcomes for those who are capable, and for community responsibility for those who are simply not capable. They believe that authority and responsibility are most effective when kept at the lowest organizational level, which meets the needs we all want to satisfy. For example, they're attuned to the concept of states' rights. In our order of service each Sunday, you'll see six uses of the word community in the descriptive texts. It is heard often in song and story. In one Sunday presentation, Reverend Martin spoke of community 6 times. I counted. And I heard it from over here, telling about the community, and so that's at least one time. Now you're going to hear it a lot more. In my dictionary, community and communicate share a common root. A key definition of community: a social group of any size whose members reside in a specific locality, share government, and have a cultural and historical heritage. An additional definition is similar character, agreement, identity as a community of interests. While these definitions do not totally exclude large numbers of people, the commonality with communicate is critical. If you played the game of telephone when you were a kid, raise your hand. Okay, you remember what happened? In my experience, amazement and laughter generally follows a game, as everyone realizes how the story changed as the succeeding people add nuance or alter fact. The written word helps solve many, problems, but it's impossible to remove the factor of successive interpretations. Consider the Jefferson Bible, or the ideas of Bishop Spong and the Unitarian Vanderbilt U professor who each spoke in Springfield recently. I invite you to consider how effective we UUs are when we work together as our community, whether in the ways we share responsibilities for our buildings and grounds, for the various committees, for the things we do on the outside, such as helping Habitat for Humanity, or raising our voices together to protest injustice, such as Illinois Innocence Project, or actively support rights, such as racial and gender equality. We work best as a community, able to understand each other, to communicate effectively, to achieve shared results. We also work well in the larger Springfield community with other groups of like persuasion. These are all workable communities because of the ability to communicate effectively and to understand each other. I read recently of an addition to my Maslow's list, socializing as one of the basic needs. Isn't that interesting? They know that at the retirement homes these days, and it's one of their key marketing points that you live longer when you have socialization. No surprise, it's fun to do things with people we know. Now let's look at these closet Republicans. Nobody's walking out. Over and over, UUs act out the Republican belief in local personal responsibility. Recently, I walked into this sanctuary to deliver the Sunday flowers and found an ad hoc committee of closet Republicans working together in response to a child's overwhelming medical and survival expenses. Recognizing the need, they were personally taking local responsibility for a fundraiser. Last Sunday, I learned it was very successful. You make me proud to be a Republican UU. Consider how our faith communities, though differing in beliefs, help feed and clothe the poor and unable. And think about the things that our friends talked about in the special Change for Change today. They are effective as community. Consider an example of important institutions here which results from community interest and community cooperation. We have 2 wonderful hospitals built and expanding with local donations from our community. Similarly, various institutions all over our great country are created by community involvement. There is a place for big overall government, but Republicans believe that big government is not the best way to achieve many of our commonly desired effects. Think of that telephone game. How many communication layers are there from the top administration of the federal community down to you who pay taxes or to those who receive the benefits of those taxes? I shudder to imagine the number, and I can't bear to check it out. One of Democrats' favorite presidents is Franklin Delano Roosevelt. In the Great Depression, he initiated excellent programs such as the CCC and the WPA, designed to provide work for men who did not have jobs. They built many worthwhile things, which we still appreciate today. If you don't know what they are, ask me later. They were paid for honest work and were able to maintain their sense of worth through personal responsibility. By the way, did you know that Republican Herbert Hoover, it's a secret, Republican Herbert Hoover proposed similar programs to FDR? FDR was wise in co-opting them, but he did change the names to his. Of course, some things unquestionably belong at the federal level. Defense of our country is defined in the Constitution. Republicans support it. Only in the strength of a unified command can any country expect to be successful in defending itself from enemies of the common weal. While growing up, I was always the littlest kid in the class, hence the one the bullies always tried to pick on. Is there an echo from last week, Martin? I am absolutely firm in my belief that young bullies turn out to be old bullies at all levels in society, as well as between nations. Republicans believe that we must maintain a very strong military, not for conquest of others, but to make us a force not to be reckoned with for protection of our own country. I am deeply concerned about current affairs. Over all the history that we know, bullies arise, grow strong, and seek larger and larger prey. The federal deficit may be our undoing. Have you counted the number of zeros in a trillion? How many have counted the number of zeros in a trillion? Good. Well, the rest of you may want to try it. I'll help you out. There are 12. Our federal debt is fast approaching $20 trillion. How much is a trillion? Well, we'll count up. 1,000 has 3 zeros. Multiply 1,000 by itself and you have 1,000,000. Multiply that 1,000,000 by 1,000 and you have 1,000,000,000. Times another 1,000 and you have 1,000,000,000,000. Wow. 1,000,000,000,000 is 1,000 billions. Some of you old timers may remember Senator Everett Dirksen, who said, a million here, 1,000,000 there, pretty soon you're talking serious money. We have multiplied Dirksen's millions in that quote up, we have multiplied it by another factor of 1,000,000,000. 1,000,000,000, billions, no, 1,000 millions make a trillion. Our national debt is a problem which seriously threatens to defeat us. Every responsible housewife and careful husband knows that you have to pay back eventually, so you must learn to live within a budget. Now here's where you closet Republicans get your fame. My favorite ALUUC closet Republicans are the board and committee members who fiercely guard the use of your contributions with careful budgeting and controls. Why can't our government do it? It is a huge problem at the state level as well as the federal. Republicans are far from perfect, believe it or not. But they are, in my opinion, the ones most cognizant of the problem and the ones most able and likely to find us help us find our way back. Let us hope that by working together and recognizing mutual problems, we will be able to find solutions before we come to ruin. I'm sorry about that. If you have ever been, I've got one piece I need to find here. If you have ever been in a brainstorming session, you found that people of goodwill develop workable plans for going forward as effective community by engaging fully in free-flowing ideas, using open minds, and leaving personal prejudices aside, listening openly without rancor, carefully evaluating potential solutions to common goals, always with the true desire for the greatest common good. Maya Angelou's beautifully illustrated poem, which appeared frequently during the 31st Olympiad, ends with, "I note the obvious differences between each sort and type, but we are more alike, my friends, than we are unlike. But we are more alike, my friends, than we are unlike." Frank was right. Let us use our powers to help and not hinder, to heal and not harm, to bless and not curse. We will then serve the spirit of freedom and deserve freedom's blessings. At last, one.
Thank goodness Bishop Spong was here. He said Unitarians would listen to anybody. But a famous conservative said, liberals will listen to other points of views, but they're astonished there are other points of views. Tomatoes? No, a good friend said, "Mick, how can you be a UU? You're not even a Democrat." I'll try to explain without telling you who to vote for in this election. Lord Acton is famous for his observation, "Power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. For me, there was even more wisdom in his statement, liberty is not the means to a higher political goal. Liberty is the higher political goal. We in this congregation are without a religious creed, but when we recite our thoughts, when lighting the chalice, we inspire. I'm moved by the ending to serve you, spirit of freedom. So thank you for this opportunity with Vi and Posy. And thanks to my beautiful and tolerant wife for helping us with this. Anyway, thank you for allowing us to give our views, and which I also hope will be an affirmation for this congregation. At the University of Illinois long ago, the Unitarians were active enough to make this farm kid curious. It was inspiring to hear that Unitarians search for the truth. It appealed to idealistic youth. My literature courses included Emerson's essays on self-reliance and nature. Emerson's friend and follower, Henry David Thoreau, with his book, Walden or A Life in the Woods, promoted, as did Emerson, self-sufficiency and self-reliance in all things, including religion. My mother, a Congregationalist with Unitarian sympathies, had been a fan of Ralph Waldo Emerson since her school days. She listened on the radio to another Unitarian, Preston Bradley, out of People's Church in Chicago. He was saying such things as, "I've never met a person, I don't care what his condition, in whom I cannot see possibilities. I don't care how much a man may consider himself a failure, I believe in him. For he can change the thing that is wrong in his life anytime he is ready and prepared to do it. Whenever he develops the desire, he can take away from his life the thing that is defeating it. The capacity for reformation and change lies within. When I returned to the family farm after college in an Air Force hitch in Korea, a friend of Mom's introduced me to this society, then a small fellowship. Here were the Weingarts, Ray, Janelle, and June, back in 1959. The Weingarts were big fans of Emerson and Thoreau. When Ray retired from IBM, the family bought a small woodsy farm where they built their own Walden Pond and could enjoy nature. They planted trees for fruit and nuts and shade, and they filled the pasture with horses and sheep and the barns with chickens, guinea hens, peacocks, and geese. They got border collies, stocked the pond with fish, and welcomed flights of Canadian geese. They had a big garden and many beehives. The Weingart Library was stocked with books by Emerson, Thoreau, and I think they had Jefferson's Bible, a copy, where Jefferson had excised the disputed passages and the supernatural from the King James Bible. The library had a lot of history, religion, and political authors. In politics, they tended toward the conservative and libertarian, but had room for others. Ray enjoyed repeating Thoreau's statement in Walden: "If I knew for certain a man was coming to my house with the conscious goal of doing me good, I should run for my life." Then later he was delighted with Ronald Reagan's quote: "The most terrifying words in the English language are, 'I'm from the government and I'm here to help.'" The Weingart's many friends here in the fellowship included the Republican Herb Hines, who ran a business school, and the Republican mayor's mother, Mrs. Howarth. Ray, then Janelle, and later June served as presidents of this fellowship, or of the fellowship, doing their part to keep Unitarianism alive in Springfield. Ray and Janelle had great respect for the conservative William F. Buckley and probably followed his philosophy when leading the fellowship. Idealism is fine, but as it approaches reality, the costs become prohibitive. However, Janelle did lead the hope we could have a new church building to honor Lincoln. She corresponded with the Unitarian and famous architect, Frank Lloyd Wright, about building it. Though Wright was willing and said, "When do we start?" the money pledged by a Western oil man was commanded elsewhere. The Weingarts were fans of William Ellery Channing, a very early leader of Unitarianism in America. Probably for quotes like this, when Channing was recalling Harvard days: "College was never in a worse state than when I entered it. Society was passing through a most critical stage. The French Revolution had diseased the imagination and unsettled the understanding of men everywhere. The old foundations of social order, loyalty, tradition, habit, reverence for antiquity were everywhere shaken, if not subverted. The authority of the past was gone," Buckley said. And Buckley said, "A conservative is a fellow who is standing athwart history, yelling, 'Stop!' Our 27th U.S. President, a Unitarian, William Howard Taft, said, quote, "Enthusiasm for a cause sometimes warps judgment." Taft also said, "No tendency is quite so strong in human nature as the desire to lay down rules of conduct for other people." I think here you often need a conservative to yell stop. Abigail Adams, a Unitarian, was asking her husband John and other founders how they could reconcile human bondage with the ideology of freedom that Americans had fought for. She was yelling stop to slavery. 49 years later, Abe and soldiers like Harriet Tubman got it stopped, almost. By the way, who isn't glad that Harriet Tubman's picture will replace that Southern Democrat on the $20 bill? If men were angels, no government would be needed. If angels were to govern men, neither external nor internal controls would be necessary, said James Madison in the Federalist Papers. And Diana DeWeese said, via great big pin she wore to service one day, "Question authority, but never your mother." That message reinforced my love for this congregation. Questioners, skeptics, doubters, dissenters, even deniers are needed to stop bad ideas in the world, out of control utopian ideas that lead to financial ruin or endanger our independence, liberty, and freedom. There is an inverse relationship between reliance on the state and self-reliance, said Bill Buckley. But that said, conservatives are proud to have defended freedom for others. In 1919, it was a Republican Congress that passed the Woman Suffrage Amendment. By the way, Republicans had tried to get the vote for women in 1879 and periodically after, but each attempt Congress voted down. In 1964, the Civil Rights Act was approved thanks to Republicans standing athwart the raging Southern Democrats. The Republicans supported the Truman Doctrine that confined the freedom-ending spread of communism and facilitated the tearing down of walls. Teddy Roosevelt busted trust, maybe not as completely as our Unitarian U.S. President William Howard Taft, which reminds us that we've had 6 Unitarian U.S. presidents, 2 Federalists, 1 Democratic Republican, 2 Whigs, and 2 Republican. Emerson was lecturing and writing, saying such things as the only safe rule is found in the self-adjusting meter of demand and supply. Do not legislate, meddle, and you stop the sinews with your sumptuary laws. Give no bounties, make equal laws, secure life and property, and you need not give alms. Open the doors to opportunity, to talent and virtue, and they do themselves justice. Property will not be in bad hands. About the same time, Karl Marx was affirming the famous slogan, "From each according to his ability, to each according to his need." We have found out the hard way that this does not work. We find that men and women judge themselves to be more needy and deserving than others, and even worse, bullies judge themselves to have most are all of the ability or virtue. Bullies are harsh rulers. So it is natural for a conservative to support a religion that calls on us to serve you, spirit of freedom. Thank you.
Life is a gift for which we are grateful. We gather in community to celebrate the glories and the mysteries of this great gift. Marjorie Montgomery. Thank you.